So this talk I gave together with a colleague at Elasticon last March. The colleague name is Igor Motov, so we have to pay tribute to him for helping with half the slides. My name is Boaz Leskes, as was mentioned, part of the development team around behind Elasticsearch. Been using it for quite a while. First as a user, then joined the company. And started actually changing the code. So Elasticsearch resiliency, when you start such a, and I see Mac autocomplete kicked in. I'll change it later. So when you speak about resiliency, the thing that actually Igor came up with was a brilliant idea to actually go look up that word and figure out what it means. So this is what stands in the dictionary, and resiliency means when bent, return to original form, right, when you have an error, and restore work as before. And we were actually very happy to find out that in the definition, in the dictionary, we had exactly what we wanted to have, which is, this is what the talk is about, okay? So we have an error, and we try to recover and make sure that we keep on doing the right thing. Now the reason why all of this is so important is that failures are just, you know, a fact of life. And that's, there's nothing much to do about it. It's just out there, and you need to deal with it. But why do you need to? Why is it so important? Okay. By the way, if you have any question, ask at any time. It's much nicer than having a long talk and then a QA session. Okay. So what's with these failures? Why are they important? Well, obviously they are always important. But if you look at clusters, I think this is Sonian cluster where Igor used to work at 2011, and that was the number of nodes they have. And everything was happy for weeks on a time, and nothing was really a problem. But these days, you know, people run this kind of things. And then when you run this kind of things, the chance that you will have a failure is actually almost guaranteed, right? You take the failure rate, multiply it by the number of nodes that you have, and if this number is higher than one, you have a failure at every given moment. So you need to deal with it at that scale. You need to do something, okay? So failures come in many flavors, and we kind of sketched them up a bit on my mat here, saying some failures are very local, specific to a single machine or a single node, but something goes wrong. Sometimes it's a harder problem, like, you know, a disk just exploded, stopped responding, and sometimes it's some other entity in the universe that decided to mess up with life and stop the node. On the other hand, you also have issues that affect the entire cluster as a whole, right? And we'll talk about it later, but the Elasticsearch cluster has this very special node called the master node, or at least the master role. One of the nodes in the cluster needs to go and do it. And if that master dies, that has implication for the entire cluster. Okay, and we need to deal with it. Same goes for network level issues, right? It sits and hooks into the communication layer between one node to another. Each node is super healthy. The problem is in between. So it affects two nodes or maybe even more. All of those are different. And you also have another scale, say some failures that you have are very fast to detect. Like if you have a network disconnect, a socket breaks, and you immediately know it happens. If you have a really dead disk, you cannot write anymore, and you immediately know it happens. But sometimes you have flaky errors, which you only discover way later, like disk corruption, right? The file was corrupted. Go find that one out. Or in the Java land, where Elasticsearch run on in JVM, sometimes you generate too much memory. And the garbage collection need to kicks in and needs to clean it up, and it usually does it in the background. But if it gets really annoyed with your application, it will actually stop the application for sometimes minutes at a time, depends on the size, the amount of memory that you have, and what it actually needs to do. So that's a very long failure in computer time, right? 1 minute of no activity for somewhere, and so you need to deal with it. And the thing is that all of them come in many flavors, and we need to somehow detect them, respond to them, architecture for them. And by doing so, we write software, right? That's how we deal with these failures. That's our only mechanism that we can use. And that one also have bugs, right? Software bug is just a failure. If something goes wrong, not as expected. And those failures are really all over the place. It can be whatever. And if you architect your software well, then this just becomes a failure, which you need to deal with, but it's not disastrous to the entire cluster. OK? Okay, so that's what we're gonna talk. Obviously, there's lots and lots and lots that can go into this. So we're gonna kind of cherry pick subjects that are interesting in the last year or so of software of development, and also we're going to look a bit into the future. So whenever you see this sign on a slide, that means it's not completed. We're still working on it, but it's interesting to know it's coming. Okay. So the first thing to talk about is all this kind of pulling the plug issues, just like instantaneous, disastrous, nothing is there anymore. What happens? Okay. And these are fairly easy to deal with because the node disappears. We know in Elasticsearch we keep 2 copies by default of each document, of each shard. And as soon as we lose a node, we have another copy. We just allocate the shard to another node that's still in the cluster, start copying the data, and we're back to where we were. Okay, so that's the easiest copy mechanism, and it will come back later as well. But sometimes you're really unlucky, and you have your 3 servers sitting in a rack, and the entire rack dies on you, and everything goes out. No electricity, nothing, right? All the nodes of all the cluster went offline. Or you have only 2 nodes went offline, but you're really unlucky, and the 2 copies of a single shard were on those 2 nodes. Okay, then there's nothing much to do. Those shards are unavailable, and you need to make sure that when the nodes come back, whatever's left on disk there is usable, and we can deal with it. Okay, so what are the implications of that? If you look at the life cycle of a single document in Elasticsearch, again, 2 shards, primary shard left side, replica shard on the right side, and as soon as the document comes in, an index, it's being put into Lucene, indexed in the Lucene. That means it's being parsed, it's being tokenized, or it's being referred into other documents already in flight. But to do so, it means it puts it in a memory buffer, right? So when we index in Lucene, we create this data structure that describes a set of documents. So you can search in that set of documents. It doesn't really make sense to do this for a single document. It doesn't end up, right? So we need to accumulate a bit documents, create this data structure, and then put them to disk and make them searchable. Those that know Lucene, that's creating a segment, which is inherent to the way it works, but it has one major downside when it comes to data persistency. It's all in memory. Okay, so if we're dealing with a set of losing power on a single server and all memory goes away, we lost the documents that were in memory. Okay, so to cope with this, Elasticsearch adds a transaction log. Okay, so as soon as we index into Lucene, we also index the document or put the document into a file, special file that's called transaction log, and make sure that when things disappear, we can reread them from there. Okay, so we accumulate the one second worth of document in the Lucene buffer. If it goes away, then Lucene takes quite a lot of care to make sure that it stays consistent and it does not mix itself with, you know, half-written files or having some of the files available and other files not available. All of that is well taken care of within Lucene, but we might lose some data. To avoid that, we have this transaction log. And once we put it here, then we can replicate it and do the same song and dance in the replica. Okay, so this is how it works, and after a certain time, the transaction log can get full, right? So what happens there? Everyone knows? Anyone knows? What happens? Transaction log is full. Yes. How is it called? Yeah. No. Almost. Flush. Okay. If you ever wonder what Elasticsearch Flush does, this is what it does. It takes transaction log and reduces it, but it cannot just, you know, shrink it and throw and remove the data in it. It has to do something to Lucene, right? Because the whole reason we had this transaction log is because these documents are in memory or put in memory segments file. So what it does, it does 2 things. It creates what's so called the Lucene commit. So it fsyncs all the file into disk, persistency, and once it got confirmation that everything that was pending so far is committed in the Lucene, into the Lucene stores, then we can clean our transaction log. Okay? So, what does it mean if you look at it? So, we discussed already the functionality. In the past, or also up to current Elasticsearch release version, we would not commit the transaction log to this using fsit all the time. And the fear or the trade-offs over there was that if you do it, we will slow down indexing because it's a relatively expensive operation. even if you write it to disk. And we say for those 5 seconds of time, we will rely on duplication between two separate machines. So the document is in two machines, two memory buffers. And if something happens and we lose this memory, we still have a copy in another place, but only for 5 seconds, right? Not for the transaction log, which is full, can be 512 megabytes of data or 30 minutes worth of indexing. It's just five seconds. And that was the rationale. Now, it turns out that with modern hardware and the current state of affairs with Lucene and Elasticsearch, we just measured it, and we tried to f-sync every single bulk request to see how much slower it will get. And it ended up being fairly limited. I think it was 7% or something like this came out of that experiment. So the trade-offs have changed, and now it doesn't make sense anymore. So as of 2.0, which is coming, we're going to f-sync on every single operation. If you still want to get the original behavior, for some reason that's your bottleneck, which is interesting anyway, you can opt out of it and set the flag somewhere and not fsync with every request. Yes? Mm-hmm. You cannot do it at the moment. You can, it's a little more intricate. So you can configure an index to put its Lucene store and some other. No, you can't, sorry. You can't, I don't think you can. I haven't heard of anyone doing it. I think in theory it might, but when you write to Lucene, you write into an in-memory buffer, right? So it's not colliding with the writing to transaction log. When Lucene actually goes and writes to disk, it's after transaction log has been written, so that's not concurrent. You can spread your shards across disks. That does make sense, right? If you duplicate all of it, and we'll talk about it in a second later. Okay? Mm-hmm. Clear so far? Mm. Good. Okay, so that's about just pulling the plug and making sure that whatever we leave behind is consistent. I think it's also worthwhile to mention something I forgot. As the same change or a similar change around the same times, make sure that when we run this transaction log and you halfway pull the plug and we're not left with a half-baked file, which was only 3 bytes into an operation was written, but we also commit the last point, which was successfully f-synced. So when we come back, we have this. And because of the change of f-syncing every request, we guarantee that it is halfway an ongoing request and not something that was successfully written before. Again, so lots of indices there. So that was on the whole node and the power supply. Now let's talk a bit about hard disk failures and what they can do. And again, those come in a couple of flavors. You have complete failures, just burn disk, done. You can run out of disk space, which is happens out there. And finally, the sneakiest part is that you have data addressed, already written, everything is good, and it's corrupted, just disk failure. Go figure out. So we're going to talk about them one by one. So again, as before, the simplest way to cope with these failures is just fall back to a replica. Fall back to another copy. You lost a disk, no problem. There's another copy. We'll start replicating to another disk, and we'll get out of it that way. So that still works. But there is one feature in Elasticsearch that used to make it slightly, the impact of such a failure, of a disk failure, slightly bigger. And that's the follows. So in Elasticsearch, if you only use one disk, that's what you use, but you can point Elasticsearch to store its data across multiple disks. And and by default, with 1x, it will choose the for every time you open a new file, it will choose the disk that has the most free space to put that new file over there. That's what we'll do. And you can change it and make it random, but that's the default behavior. And that's all very nice. But it had the side effect that all your shards, all the data, was spread out across all disks, right? Because every time a shard needs to write a new file, doesn't matter what the file is, it will choose a disk, that is, disk that was the least used at that point, and write the file over there. So you ended up with a situation where the data is actually spread out across all the disks that you had on the machine. And then when disaster happens and we lose a disk, what happens? Exactly. And that's not good, right? That doesn't scope the change to a single shard so we can copy. So suddenly a machine that had, 100 shards or 200 shards lost all of them, and the cluster needs to copy 200 shards between other nodes. And that's a shame. So as of as of 2.0, it's already committed, we have changed its behavior to be slightly less efficient in data distribution sense, and only to use a specific disk for specific shards. So the data of a single shard will never cross multiple disks. However, multiple shards will be spread out across the multiple disks that you have, which gives you even a nicer speed up when it comes to writing. Okay? So that's a complete disk failures, but as I said, something else can happen. You can just fill up your disks. And when you fill up your disk, you get half-written files. And half-written files are kind of okay if you cope with them and deal with them. And again, Lucene is a very nice checkpointing mechanism that you say, I'm going to write the file first, then I'm going to write a temporary file pointing to the new file, and then I'm only when I successfully filled everything, then I can swap it and make it live, so I know that everything was successfully written before it's being referenced. That's very nice. However, we did not have these things for other files in Elasticsearch. And as we go on, we add more and more places where we do this. And also, we help avoid it. So we have something that's called a disk allocation decider that actually decides where to put shards in Elasticsearch. So one of the things the master does is decides here's a shard, which node should have it. Okay, he took obviously the first one, the node actually should have it on disk, right? Otherwise, methods make sense. But now we want to put a copy on somewhere else, which node should have it? And one of the things that it's really important to check that the node can actually hold a shard and does not run out of space. And if you index into a node that has 20 shards and that disk usage goes up and up and up, at some point it's a good idea to start offloading shards from that node because it gets filled. Okay, so we had this for quite a while, but since 1.3.5, it's actually on by default, and that's it. It's sometimes a bit of a pain if you work on a laptop, which you only have 1 GB free of disk space, and you start Elasticsearch, and it doesn't want to allocate replicas anywhere. And the reason is that for one laptop, maybe 1 GB is fine, but as far as Elasticsearch is concerned, this is not a lot of disk space. Start offloaded. Right? So that's the allocation awareness when it comes to disk space. So let's talk about the last version of disk corruption, which is data. And that has to do this property, right? We have a 10 GB segment file. And then somewhere, our lovely hardware, file system, whatever, decided to flip a bit. It can also be a network card that goes on. We had a bug at the compression library that hits every once in a while and just flips a bit somewhere. And the problem with this issue that when it happens, it doesn't have any effect. It's okay, bit flipped, it's there, it's lying on disk, and you find out way later that it is the case when you try to search the data that just accidentally sit in that area. That's when you find out. So it can be years later, months later, you just don't know. So how do you deal with this? You add a footer to each file that checks on the entire content of the file. So now, if you really wanted to, you can check, verify that this 10 GB actually checksums to this file. And this has a side effect that if a file is truncated, it's also very easy to detect because you just read the last bytes of the file. And if this is not this magic footer marker that you have, then it's something else. This was a half-written file, which is good in that context. So at least we have a mechanism to detect, but it doesn't mean that it's easy to detect because you actually use this mechanism. You need to read 10 gigabytes worth of data, which is slow and taxing if you do it fast. Okay, so you have to use this mechanism in care, and we continue, but we do it when we can. So first thing, what do you can? If the files are really small, we do it all the time. That's very easy to do. Okay, every time we move data around for whatever reason, we check the checksums. So copying data between shards, what we call relocation. It checks. Every time you back up your data, we read the data, we check out, right? So we don't, what thing you could do if because we copy file when we snapshot them, we just copy the bytes as they are, and now we have a corrupted backup, and you don't even know about it. So every time we move data around, we check those things. And finally, as I said, the transaction log itself is checksummed as well. Oops. Whenever we write it, when we complete open a transactional file, we can make sure that the content is the same as we used to expect. And finally, those checksums are actually a form of identity marker. So in Lucene, you have a set of files called segment files, and the segment has a file for the free text search data structure. It has another file for the content itself, the stored fields, the original source of the document, and it also has a couple of other files. And all of them together forms the logical segment. And when you have this set, you want to make sure that those are the file you actually mean to have, right? It's nice that they have the same file name, which is typically okay, but sometimes things get mixed up, right? If you move a shard over and you put it another shard in the same folder and something got wrong with the data deletion, and there is a file name which is named the same, but it's totally different content. So how do you detect it? You can compare the checksums of the file and see that it's actually what you expect. And that's a good technique, but it has a downside that if you try to check some small files, you are likely to have hash collisions because it's the same content. Just a bigger file. So to avoid all of this, instead of checking individual file, we take this entire set of a segment, which is 4 or 5 files, and all of the checksums of all of those files have to match before we declare that segment as what we expect to find. Okay. So what is ongoing in that area? We have checksumming of the metadata file. So up to 1.5, we will not checksum the cluster state when we serialize it. So that's the metadata information as to which fields are there, what are there, is a long double string, and so forth. All of those are checksum right now. And you have an optional way of saying when you open up a node and you access the data for the very first time, if it's really important, you can tell Elasticsearch to run through all the data and do verify the checksums at the end. Okay, so scan those 10 gigabytes of data, calculate the checksum, make sure what it is. It is slow. Okay, that's what it is. The reason why it's new is that we always have the option to actually check the internal structures of the index and make sure that they are okay. And that's even more expensive. Okay, so the new thing in it is to allow you to say only check the checksum option, not the entire structure, and don't unpack everything. Don't check that it actually makes sense. Just make sure that it's the same, okay, as it used to be. So that's an option. Finally, with Lucene, instead of relying on the checksum, which is, as I said, can have hash collision, they also introduced the notion of actual segment ID. Right, really a GUID that's generated every time, and then you can refer to these things with a true ID rather than an implied checksum. Yes? I don't know. Murmur. 3? CS3? CS32 because of native something support. I remember, if I remember.
Was that understandable for everybody?
Yeah, I'll repeat the answer.
Okay, thanks.
So it used to be Adler 32 because in old JVM versions it's apparently faster, but it changed in recent one where CRC 32 is much, much faster, was just said. So that changed. Okay. And speaking of Java version, the last bullet point here. Java version, as any other piece of software, has bugs, and when the JVM has bugs, bad things happen. Weird things happen. We test continuously all the JVM versions out there, and it depends on what we see in terms of bugs. And we sometimes declare a JVM version, a specific minor builds is like this one is no good. It causes known corruption, and then we add it to a list. And when you start Elasticsearch under those JVMs, you will get a warning that's not a good idea. It will refuse to start, and you can override it with this a special marker. No, I really need this JVM, and that's it. Go. So that's that one. Questions so far? Except for Zach? Okay, so now we're going to move from the realm of single node data storage and go slightly higher to see how those nodes operate together. Okay, and distributed system can have funky stuff like this, where one node just decides to do something else and go fight it out. With it, so you need to detect it and do something about it. As before, they come in many ways and flavors and change characteristics in terms of speed, detection, implication, and so forth. These are the ones going to talk about today. So complete node failure. Again, that's the easiest one. It's a very clear-cut case. Node is dead. Socket is broken. Network is not there. It's clearly communicated, and you can do something else. What Elasticsearch by default will do is take all the data, all the shards of what was on that node, and give it a new home. And when the node comes back, say, okay, fine, I'm going to move data back to you. And sync everything, make sure that everything that was indexed in the meantime is carried over, and so forth. So that's the easy one. But sometimes you have unresponding node or just generic network failures with things, you know, you send requests and they don't come back. So how do we deal with this? And by default, Elasticsearch pings the master nodes, pings every other node in the cluster every 1 second. Say, are you there? Are you there? Are you there? Are you there? And if it fails to respond within a certain amount, the node will be declared dead, even if it might not be dead, thrown off the cluster. And the same thing will happen as in bullet number one. And the same help to deal with the fact that a more esoteric network failure where sockets are not broken, it's not a clear-cut break, but the socket is there, just you put something on it and it doesn't arrive on the other side. Just times out, disappears. Okay, so it's the same behavior. So let's move on, starting with unresponsive nodes. Why would a node be unresponsive? Okay, so there's many reasons, but the number one reason for that is up here on the slide, memory. And why memory? Because we run under the JVM. It's a managed memory environment where we can allocate memory, but we cannot deallocate memory. The only thing we can say is we don't need this memory anymore. JVM, deal with it, clean it up whenever you want. And that cleanup process is called garbage collection. Garbage collection is something that's done in the background. The problem with this garbage collection is that it tries its best to do it in the background, but it can also get annoyed with your application and say, you know what, you move aside now, I'm going to deal with this memory. And this can happen really bad if it needs to defragment 32 gigabytes worth of data. Just move them around, and that can take 2-3 minutes, 1.5 minutes, depends on CPU, hardware, and so forth, and so forth. And again, 1.5 minutes of not responding to pings, we throw the nodes off the cluster. So what can cause memory pressure? Number one, these days in the 1.x version, is the so-called field data structures. These data structures allow you to have random access to document value, so field values of a document. So for example, if I'm indexing, I don't know, game results of multiple players, and then I want to know what the average score is, or what is the top score, I need to go through all the documents that match this query and retrieve a value. For each document, retrieve a value. In this case, it would be the score of that specific game. And if I do it for one query, I will touch certain set of documents, but then I do it for another query, and it will be completely different set of documents. And overall, as this query roll out, you need to access, to have basically random access patterns to that data. And so random access pattern is nice, but to do it fast, you need to have memory, the thing in memory. And that was the idea. And the implementation that we have in 1x called field data is loaded actually within the JVM heap, right? So the JVM, it's just allocated in the JVM memory. That means that if you have much of it, the garbage collection will have to clean it up. So that's the field data. As I said, it's used for statistics, which is the aggregation bullet point over there. It also needs to use it for sorting, which is the same story. Compare documents really fast, and this time this set of documents, the other time another set of documents. If you use document data in your scripts, we don't know what the script is doing. And again, typically those scripts will be run as part of your query or a part of your analytics code. So we have the same time. And finally, if you use the parent-child relationship, the join, we need to cross this bridge between parent and child and child parent quite often. And those will be loaded into memory as well. Okay? So this is loaded into memory. The good news, maybe bad news, is that it's loaded on demand. Okay? So it's only loaded when you actually need it. When the first query that hits those fields happens or executed Elasticsearch, that's where Elasticsearch goes and reads the index and loads the data into memory. This is good news because you only load the stuff that you need. It's also bad news because the first query that happens to hit those data structure will actually have to suffer the pain of constructing them. To work around that, you will have the Warmers API. So you can turn Elasticsearch to execute these queries in the background for you before it exposes data to searching. And you can also look at the mappings and configure a certain field to eagerly preload the field data. But for the sake of the argument, for the sake of discussion about the resiliency, it doesn't really matter. It's loaded into memory, and it needs to fit into memory. Okay, so this was the number one reason why you'll have garbage collection. So long GC pauses and nodes falling off the cluster. So to deal with it, we started introducing a notion called circuit breaker. Okay, so the circuit breaker is not really new. It's been there for as of 1.0. And the job of circuit breaker is before it starts to execute a query to try to guess how much memory this query will need. Okay, so it looks at the fields that it touches, look at the amount of data that those fields had. There was two talk at Berlin Buzzword about all the compression techniques you can apply to this data in order to make sure it uses less memory. But it still it needs memory. And as time progresses, this circuit breaker will add to more and more pieces of the code. So this prevents us from creating memory pressure and going out of memory, but it does not mean that it prevents you from giving good user experience, right? To do the queries that your application demands, you still need that amount of memory. You need it, otherwise queries. But instead of going down, we reject the queries, which is a much better failure than the original one. Okay, so it's something to remember. It's not that it saves you. It just saves you from going down. Still, the queries will still be rejected. So that was the situation up to more or less 1.4. For quite a while now, Lucene has had another data storage format, which is called doc values. And we basically have the same access pattern. You can give it a document ID, it will give you back a value from a specific field. The difference with these doc values is that unlike field data, it is stored on disk. Okay, so it's stored on disk. And as such, they are slower. However, there was quite a bit of work in Lucene to make them, to improve them, make them faster. And as of 1.4, we feel that they start to become a viable option, a viable replacement for the field data memory. They need to be computed at index time, right? It's something that we prepare and put on disk. So it's not like the field data, which is dynamic. You need to say in your mapping, enable doc values for this specific field. However, they have proven to be such a good alternative right now that from 2.0 and up, those doc values will be created by default for all the fields where they make sense. So all the numeric fields and all the not analyzed fields. Those are the keyword fields that are typically used in the context of aggregation. Okay. Also do note that if you leave them on disk, they will still be slow. So the assumption is that you have enough machine memory to load the relevant pieces of those doc values structures into the file system cache, which is still in memory, but it's an off heap out of JVM memory. So it's not a memory, a part of memory where the garbage collection is in shadow, so having lots of those, 200 gigabytes of those is fun. If you want to write 200 gigabytes of field data within the JVM, you'll really have trouble. Okay, so it's much better managed memory, which is where this is going. Okay? So that's interesting development. It's really big. I mean, like I don't know for those who use Elasticsearch if you've seen it, but this is huge in terms of cluster stability. So other things around memory in Elasticsearch, no one stopped you from asking, here's a search and I want to have the top 1 million results for it in one go, one batch. And it so happened that 1 million documents just not fit in memory. It's nothing much you can do. So, but you can still do it and bring your Elasticsearch node down. We now, as of 1.5, just reject those. Yeah. Those 50-50, that's a good question. So the question was whether now that we use doc values from 2.0, we change our best practice recommendation to do 50-50. Probably it will. I don't know what to tell you what the 50-50 would be. However, that was really 50-50. What you should really do is measure. Okay, so run your data set, run your queries, see the garbage collection part, the memory pattern. So you should plot your memory usage, which is exposed to the API, and say, okay, it's going up, garbage collection, going up, garbage collection, and you take that lower part. That's the memory you need. You get some margin, and that's your memory. The rest, file system caches. Right. By the way, I forgot to mention, but everything that's strike through That changed from when we gave the talk at Elasticon and actually today. Okay, so today 1.5 is released. It's available. So that hard, that hard limit has a change. So we have a really hard limit. So I don't remember the default. I think it was something like 10,000. You can just reject every request that asks for more than 10,000 documents at one go. If you do want to use more, there is a different search type called scan and scroll that will give you as many as you want, but isn't batches, not at one go. And we have been discussing ways to make it slightly smarter, right? Because not all documents are the same. Some documents have 500 megabytes text in them. Some documents have two numbers in them, right? So this 10,000 is really kind of a hard limit to get something feasible out there. So we're thinking about how to design a circuit breaker that will be more adaptive to the current state, how many concurrent requests you have, and these kind of things. Another memory probably you can get is when you do an analysis of complex data, and you can ask an aggregation to get the average price per day, per country, per game type for different, for different type of users. Okay, so you have you can end up in a situation where you have so many possible combinations that the temporary space that Elasticsearch used to keep the counting going while running can be too much. Okay, so so just the possible combination of all the countries in the world, time all the games in the world, time all the users in the world, time the possible results is just too much. It doesn't feed up in memory. And we can do some stuff to try to avoid it. There are multiple approaches how to do it. They are stated here. The kind of rough idea of how this goes is to say, instead of doing it all in one go and calculate all the options that we need, we can say, calculate one layer first, so figure out what the top countries are, and then decide it's only these five, and then reduce only analyze the data that actually fits in one of those five, as opposed to calculate for all. So think, for example, an aggregation that runs for all the usernames. It's you can say I'm calculating all the username, and every time a document is put into one of users, I'm going to calculate everything that's below it as well, and then only later decide which usernames are actually relevant for me. It's a more efficient approach to say first figure out which usernames are relevant, and then only do the calculation for the result for those specific 10 users out of the millions that I have. Okay, the problem here is how to decide it automatically. Internally, based on many options, we already do this optimization on the lowest leaf of the tree, right? If you have an analysis tree, the lowest part is where we can get smart, but we need something for the higher levels. So that's that. And last but not least, at Elasticsearch these days, we have something called filter cache. We cache the result of filters because we assume they will be repetitive and useful. Those are super compressed into form bit arrays. But still, if you have lots and lots and lots of them, that can overflow. So as of, I think it was introduced in Lucene 5, which will be part of version 2.0 of Elasticsearch, we will automatically figure out how to populate that cache. Instead of putting every filter in it or removing every filter, we'll look at the type of the filter, how much is it used, so you get these counters going, how expensive it is to create. Because if a filter can be created just so, there is no point in caching it. Just don't cache it. However, it's very heavy. It's more efficient to cache those instead. So all of that is being calculated. As you can see, it is a huge change in Lucene 5. Filters and queries become the same. Okay, so we're not ready in Elasticsearch yet to remove all that distinction from the DSL, and such just a lot of work. But the fact that Lucene does not make the distinction anymore means that the filter caching are actually now query caching, okay? And also note that we can also cache queries on Elasticsearch these days. You can enable it, it's not enabled by default. This is not the same, okay? So the Elasticsearch query cache will be renamed to request cache, where we cache the entire request, including aggregations and hits and everything that you want to return. And then below the hood, we can leave it up to Lucene to have smarter query caching. Okay, questions so far? Yes. It's not so expensive. You always have to look with these kind of things, what it is exactly. My wild guess is that those scans are built to pick things up from disk and return relatively a lot of result, as opposed to the top 20 or top 10, that's a typical search, and that you will just, you know, max your I/O layer. Just you want too much, a bit from here, a bit from there, a bit from there, and it's just spinning around. Maybe not, I'm not sure. Okay, Hot Threads is your friend. You can see where it is. Simon have another idea. Yeah. You mean the scroll, right? The search after, but that's not relevant for the scan. It's relevant if you scroll a sorted search, then it's relevant, right? So you use scanning or normal searching? Unscored, okay. Okay, it's interesting, but sure. So let's talk after the. After the presentation is finished, and see what it is. Just curious. Okay. So the takeaway from all of this, or one of the takeaways, is that all of this memory consumption is really related to data, right? Searches, field data, moving data around. All of this is data. And if you remember, I said in the beginning there is one node in the cluster. It's called the takes the role of a master, and that node needs to make decisions on the cluster level. Now, it's really bad if that specific node is overloaded with data and goes to sleep for 1.5 minutes because of garbage collection. Okay? So that's an amplification from an error that happened on a specific node but have a cluster-wide effect. And that's a bad thing. So to deal with it, as soon as you have a decently sized cluster, and that's obviously very vague, it's a trade-off, please do separate three nodes to only do master level role. Do not do searches, do not do data, do not do anything, just be there available to manage the cluster. Because they just need to manage the cluster, they actually don't do anything or don't do much. The important part is that they are available to do something all the time. And that also means that they not need to be very big. Okay, so it can be a JVM process with, I don't know, 2-3 gigabytes depending on the cluster size. And that's it, and leave all your data nodes to actually have data and deal with search, and this is the one that you need to grow out as you scale out your cluster, okay? Three masters node is more than enough for doing everywhere. As your data goes, give it to data, and of course the question becomes, when do I make this split? And the answer is, as soon as you can economically afford it, as soon as it makes sense in your context, right? Some people really want to have their availability and store lots of data on your node, and then say, okay, they have three data nodes and three master nodes. Some people say, okay, up to 10 nodes, it just doesn't make sense to have three dedicated master nodes next to them. Even in those cases, you can say, put another process on the same physical machine. Okay, so to Elasticsearch, a process is a node, not a physical machine. And that way you create another process which is protected from all this garbage collection, ready to do the master operations. Okay, so that's an important strategy to make sure that things behave well on a cluster level. Those used to be more important in the past. Now the clients are smarter, so they can round robin themselves and retry and sniff the cluster and find out what data nodes are there. In very extreme cases, they might be useful because it allows you to separate concerns. Within a search, you have the scatter phase and then reduce phase, and maybe it's the reduce phase that's expensive or different, like you can play with it more, but I think most of the time it turns out to be just more of a headache than something useful. So yeah, that's why they are not on the slide. Okay? Okay, let's move on. Network issues. So network is the information broker, right? This is how nodes speak to each other, this is how they share information, this is how they find out stuff. So when the network plays tricks with us and cuts cables, then we have a information barrier between two sides of the cluster. And when this happens, the master, as we said before, cannot ping these two nodes on the other side of the partition. So what it will do is just throw them away, right? The problem is with this kind of thing is that those other two nodes, to them, it looks like the master died. And also the other three nodes. So they, well, it's a highly available piece of software, right? It needs to deal with failure. So what do? Elect a new master. And when they elect a new master, suddenly they've become independent of the other nodes. They can do whatever they want. They can accept indexing requests and will not replicate the indexing, the data across the barrier. So if you ask one side, it'll tell you one thing. You ask the other side, it will tell you another version of the document. And that's a bad place to be. So that's called a split brain, right? Two hemispheres, totally independent, doing whatever they want, make decisions. And that's a problem that's inherent to any distributed, highly available system. We just need to deal with it. So the way that Elasticsearch deals with it is by configuring a so-called setting, a setting called minimum master nodes. Okay? So minimum master node says how many nodes need to be available or visible to me in order to become a master or to be a valid a master. And you need to set it to half your cluster plus one, which is a quorum, which makes sure that no split brain can occur. Because one side will have guaranteed less nodes than that setting. So in this specific case, you set it to three, these two nodes on the right side will stop accepting indexing requests and wait for the network partition to go away. And at this point, they will discover the other side of the cluster and join it again. Okay. So now, the question is, why don't we do it by default? Why do you need to set it? Sorry? You could. If you will break this like this, right, there is a more crazy partition going on. Yeah, all the cluster will go down. But I think that's preferable to having this split brain. Because then you have two versions of the same documents, and how do you resolve those two? And it's a much messier place to be. What else? Exactly. We have no idea how many nodes are part of the cluster, right? We don't know. There's something you need to tell Elasticsearch how many there are. So that's why you have to set it. And again, so I think it's the number one most important setting to set. Let's not leave it the default, but our advice in general is to stay away from those settings. Leave everything at default until you have some issue. This is a big, big exception to the rule. Do set it. First thing you need to do. Okay? So that's how it works with sorry. Okay. That's how it works for complete partition, for full partition of two sides. But a network can play tricks, and there's one such trick. So instead of partitioning the cluster in two clean halves, it just breaks the connection between two specific nodes. That's all. And then in this specific case, minimum master node doesn't really help. Because if you look at the nodes on the, what is it, middle right, it doesn't see its master. It's pinging its master, and the master is just not responding. So it thinks the master is dead, but the master is not really dead. On the other hand, it can ping any other node in the cluster. So if you look at this minimum master node, it has enough, right? It can see four nodes, which is good. Same holds for any other node. So if you're really unlucky, that node itself can become also a master. So I have enough voters, I have enough people in my cluster, so I can become a master. And then we're still back to square one, where we have two active masters in a cluster, which is a bad situation. So with 1.4, the main theme of that release 1.4 was to solve this issue. And the way we solved it is to introduce another gossiping round. And so we didn't talk about master election, but the first thing in the initial cluster forming, as we start pinging the network, saying out who is out there, what's going on, what is there an active master, not an active master, what's going on? Okay, the original thought was that we need to elect a new master really fast, right? So a master is super important for the correct operations of the cluster. So as soon as the master is gone, a new master needs to be elected in order to index. That turns out to be problematic in this context, because it would just say, okay, we need a new master, I'm being master, I have enough nodes, I'm going to assume these roles. But on the other hand, you're more liable to this kind of partial knowledge situation where you think the master is dead, but it's not really dead. So to avoid it, what we introduced is a new gossiping round. So even in this case, this node will go out, ping the universe, and say, who's out there, what's going on? And then the other node will just tell it, well, there is a master, it's there. The node will say, okay, fine, I'm going to join that master again. We'll fail to do so, go back to pinging, find out the master again, try to join, fail, and so forth until the network partition is resolved and everything is fine again. So that's what we did. But it is kind of tricky because it takes time to do, right? If you want to do the gossiping, it takes 3 seconds by default. And those 3 seconds, that node cannot accept indexing rights anymore because it does not have a valid master. Its master has died, or at connection, the master died. So to allow to deal with it, we now allow reads when there is no master. By default, you can change it. And you will, if you ask that query, that node for data, it will serve you based on the last data that it knows and route your queries based on that. You might get stale data, but you will not be able to write because for this, you still need a master. Okay, so these are the improvement in 1.4, and what we yes. Okay, so like Zookeeper. So the question was, why do we use a custom discovery mechanism and master election, right? If I reformat the question a bit, so that's a very good question. We use an algorithm called Boolean election, which is fairly naive, and that's its problem as well. The reason why it's like this is that all the standard algorithms do not fit this elasticity model of Elasticsearch. So you need to know in advance which nodes are there and what they do, okay? Or they have this kind of properties. So you need to take them and adapt them, and that's just a take work, and that's what we are doing, okay? So we're working on a very common thinking about whether we use Raft, which I think is likely where it's headed, where we use it as is, or we chop it into pieces and take one piece for this and do another one with this one. So I think it's a valid question, and there's definitely a direction we are going. Just take, it's not as trivial as it sounds. So that just take something is not, sadly not the case. Okay? Yes?
Sorry.
Please. With the dedicated master nodes, and you propose 3, the minimum number of master nodes would always be 2.
Yes.
That's correct. Okay.
If you set it up that way, which we don't.
Is what you recommend?
Yes. Okay. Yeah. As soon as it's become economically viable, set in three dedicated masters, set it to minimum master node 2. While we're at it, set the unicast discovery to point to those 3 nodes, and that's it.
And if it's enough to have a small JVM on an otherwise used node, then I mean it's always economically viable to have separate master nodes.
Yeah,
right?
But there is an operational complexity involved, right? Like it's more a philosophy. We also invest quite a lot of time in your initial experience, so you start up and it just works, right? So you start discovering things from there, and that has one of these implications, another key distinction with Zookeeper. For example, if you want to set it up, you need to know what you're doing and configure many things and so forth and so forth. Not saying it's bad, I'm just saying it has a cost that comes with it. Okay, so
There's another question back there.
Oh, sorry.
Speak up a little bit.
Yeah. Yes.
Can you quickly repeat the question, please?
It was kind of long. I think there was 2 parts to the question. Tell me if I missed something. So the first part is, what do you do when you do hit out of memory? And the second part is where you can be proactive. And when you see a node has too many garbage collections, if you proactively kick it off the cluster, right? Yes, so let's start with the second part first. We could do this. It's a bit tricky to find the run parameters. The good news is that as soon as a node goes into a long GC, it will be thrown off the cluster because it will not respond to these 1 second pings, okay? No, when you go into long GC, so it's about how garbage collection works. There is a short GC, which is stop the world, but very quickly. There is a log GC, which is happening in the background, and it has another stop the world part, right? That's the problematic part, and that's typically like a couple of milliseconds. the problem, it becomes problematic if this phase becomes 40, 50, 60 seconds. At that point, your application doesn't do anything. It doesn't respond to ping, it doesn't do anything. It's really blocked, okay? No, it's paused. It's like that. So in that point, it will fall off the cluster. What we can do better there, as data structure improves, is reduce the timeout from 30 seconds. The reason why it's so high is these GCs. Do not throw a node off the cluster too fast. Because throwing a node off the cluster have a big cost implication. It means the data will start to move around, and gigabytes will be copied from here to there. Right? So you need to find a good balance between these two. As memory becomes less of an issue, and doc values, for example, we remove data off heap, then it probably makes sense to reduce this timeout as well. So that's that part. Second part is what to do when the out of memory actually happens. And at that point, there's nothing else but kill the node. Because the JVM is so that once you have an out of memory, it really depends which thread had it and at what point, but it can be left in unstable state and it will start doing crazy stuff. Especially if it's the master node. Yeah. Crazy master, as again, is amplified to the entire cluster. So that's even more important to clear it over there. Yes. Yeah. I think you can configure it, but I'm not sure of a good way. I think there's more JVM experts there if you really want to fight the detail on that one. But the best approach is to take a step back, monitor your memory, and make sure that you don't come close to that. Because again, it's not a good place to be in to begin with, right? It's like this circuit breaker. If you hit it, it's still a problem. It's just a different type of problem. And it's a better problem to have, but it's still a problem. Okay? So try not to get the cluster, size your cluster, see that you're starting to have memory pressures there, add nodes, add capacity, right? On time. That's the good way to deal with it. Okay. That's it. Okay, so other minor improvements. We had this interesting issue. Where someone reported the bug and said, I set my minimum master nodes through the API. It's dynamically updatable because you can add nodes, right, as you go. And I did. I had a mistake. I put an extra zero there. I want to write 10, but I wrote 100, and I submitted it to the master. And the master said, "Oh shit! I need 100 nodes. I don't have 100 nodes. I'm going down. I'm not a master." And then from that point on, you cannot change it anymore because it's a cluster-wide setting. You need a master to change it. Cluster went down. Okay, so that was like, we need to do something about it. So it was in 1.5, it will refuse to accept settings that do not make sense in the current live cluster. So that's that one. Another interesting one is what happens where if you have this situation and all this master becomes unresponsive and the nodes decide to throw away the master, which don't want you. You're in long GC, you're not responsive, we need a new master. We have 4 nodes, we can elect a new master, we will elect a new master, and then the old master woken up, said, "Well, I'm here and I have stuff to say and I'm going to tell you what to do." And before up to 1.5, such a stale master could drive the cluster crazy. So the node said, okay, you're a master, I'm going to do what you say. And only way it would resolve in the past is say, if this master happened to send command to a new master, the new master will say, no, I'm a master as well, and we're going to fight it out and decide who's going to be the new master. But if you had this situation, well, they will never speak to each other. They can drive all the other nodes crazy. And that was fixed, so a node will refuse to accept cluster state updates from anything but its current master. Okay, that's changed. So that's what this 9632 means. And finally, in the context of memory pressure, in huge deployments, I'm really talking about huge deployments, the cluster state itself is 100 megabytes compressed. And because there are very frequent changes, typically, they keep on publishing this cluster state. And then if nodes are slow to process it, you can accumulate a couple in the queue. And that creates also memory pressure. Again, very huge deployments, hardly unusual. But to support this, we now transmit just a different essential change. So when you change one field in one index somewhere, This will result in currently in publishing of the entire cluster state, so all the metadata of all the indices and all the location. And as of with 2.0 and upper, will only change, send the change in that specific mapping for that specific index. Okay. So that's the end of the part of what we can deal with problem within the cluster. But you also have to remember that problems can also come from the outside. Okay. So you need people can push you and make you do things that are kind of unfeasible to do. We already saw one example of it in a circuit breaker, which someone asks a query, which is impossible to answer within the constraint that you have for memory. So we just, you know, push back. But there are other ways, and that's really important to think about it, because that's a bit out of our hands. Okay? That's something in the design of our system. So for example, things that we can do is that we only have so many in-flight requests. We don't accept more that. We cannot put more of those in the queue. That's it. Queue is full. Okay. So when you see ES rejected operation exception, that means, sorry, queue is full. We reject the operation. So you can do two things. You can say, well, you know, this is stupid that this queue is only 1,000 long. I'm going to make it 50,000 long. That's it. Problem solved. Your IADs. But memory pressure is around the corner. Okay. So you need to design your system such that if you get this back pressure from Elasticsearch, push back to who is ever supplying the data and make sure that you have some space to put the data temporarily, even if it's in disk or some queuing mechanism or whatever, so you can let Elasticsearch say, okay, now I'm I was busy with something, I'm done, I can catch up on it without. So you have a much healthier system. Same goes for thread pools. Thread pools control the amount of concurrent operations that can go on, and the same goes. So we have, for example, our indexing thread pool that says how many concurrent indexing operations could go and be executed at the same time. We bound them smartly, so we look at the amount of CPUs that you have, the amount of cores, and we based our defaults based on that. If those all of those thread pools are busy, again, it doesn't make sense to increase it to more threads, because there is no more CPU in that machine, right? So you have more threads, more in-flight operation, more things in memory, less efficient use of resources, bad things. So again, back pressure is something to accept and do something about it. Don't just try to create more resources by tweaking settings. It's typically the wrong scenario. Okay. There is some issue of someone issuing a query, and that query touches every single document in all my 200 million documents on a node, and it's, you know, brought a denial of service for all the other people, and we want to stop it on time. So this is something we're busy with, trying to do it efficiently. So this query runs, right, and it processes these 200 million documents. And what you effectively say is that every time it checks a document, you need to see how much time has passed. And if my timeout has expired, I have to stop. Okay? But this is really tight loop that has to spin really fast. And now we add a check. So it becomes like 30% slower, something like this. So you need to find the right place to put those checks in place. And the trade-off is not slow down the query. On the other hand, check often enough to respond to honor timeouts. By and large, the good news here, this is never on a millisecond resolution. So you can find a way. So that's we're dealing with. And then last interesting insight, when you index to Elasticsearch Lucene, we create those segment files. So we buffer documents, right? We flush, create segment, buffer document, flush and segment. Something needs to keep the amount of segments in our Lucene index under control. Because if you just do this all the time, you will have infinite amount of searches, segments. And it turns out also that search time is linear in the number of segments that you have to touch. So searches will also slow down. Same goes to indexing to a certain degree. Right? So something needs to keep this under control. That something is called the merge process. A merge process is a breakdown process that takes these segments and merges them together, just to bigger segments. And we can talk quite a lot about these merges issues if you want to know more search merge policy. And then Mike McCandles, which is one of the committers to Lucene, and they have a very nice blog called Changing Bits. You can, and he has a lot of information about it, including nice videos that shows how it works. But the good news is that sometimes you can overflow that merge policy. You can create too many segments too fast by indexing, and that it will not have time to clean up. And before you know it, you end up with 1,000 segments, and things go south for now. It's typical with this kind of system. As soon as you hit the threshold, it immediately everything goes bad, right? You need to stay away from that. So to make sure that doesn't happen, as to 1.2.0, we detect that there's too many segments, that merges are falling behind, and we throttle the incoming indexes. So we effectively reduce all the concurrency for an incoming indexer and say, all of you need to queue up into one thread and do your thing until the merge catches up. Again, a scenario which you need to see, anticipate, and slow down indexing because your queues will fill up as well. Okay, so this is forms that we from Elasticsearch push outside. It's something to design, accept, and do something, and just don't try to push back, as it were. The queue is per shard per node. Per node. So as you add nodes, you add capacity resources, you'll have more larger queues because you have 1,000 items on a new node. Yeah. As well. So yeah, more nodes is more resources. We can do more. That's the good answer. Yeah. I don't know if you want to formulate it that way, but it's resources versus stuff, right? There's no magic bullets here. You need to do things. You need enough resources to do the things. The good news about Elasticsearch, it allows you to efficiently use those resources and to scale out. Right? As you add node, the shard distribution will spread out as well. That means that there's less concurrency on a single resource, and so forth and so forth. Okay, so in the context of resiliency, there's one big issue, and that problem is that there's so many stuff that can happen in this complex system, and we definitely don't know all of those, right? And it's something to recognize and to think about. And the way we try to deal with it is to say, let's try to simulate failures. Let's try to continuously pull plugs, obviously not really literally that way, create havoc in the network, flip bits in our files, and try to see. And we have quite a big testing farm doing this all the time, running our tests all the time and flipping random bits in files. And sometimes you get unlucky, and that single random bit was in a very crucial place, and you say, like, not good. And that's how, for example, we found this bug in the compression layer. There's something just, you know, didn't end up here, and we looked it up. And we saw, hey, in this specific circumstance and chain of events, this can happen. We didn't think about it. Okay? Which brings us to the third bullet point here. It's you need to be evil and do all kind of chaotic stuff, but if you cannot reproduce them, it's useless. Right? So say we have this exception. Something broke. And what happened? Well, I don't know. I need to look at it. We need to open a debugger. And we need to carefully think what's going on there. And so if you cannot reproduce the error, it's useful, but way less useful than a reproducible thing. And that's, again, there are talks about it. You can Google it. It's inspired by the testing infrastructure in Lucene. They do the same, and we port it over to Elasticsearch as well. And finally, still, you guys are the best source of telling us what happened when you saw specific errors. So when you open a GitHub issue, please try to get the details, especially with this kind of errors. They are super hard to trace. The little details really count. And to compute this, this is a snippet from a web page that we have. That web page is available on the Elasticsearch/resiliency. Here you can see the age of the talk. The slide was made for before the company renamed its name. So it's now elastic.co/guide/whatever. And this page was created in recognition that it's pretty hard to go through all the GitHub issues and follow them. We try to label all of them resiliency. So if you really want to know the actual little details of development, follow that label. But it can be daunting and hard. So we created a page which explains all the currently known issues, what exactly they are in normal speak, and then also a big list of everything that was fixed and happened. So if you want to know more, that's your place. It's an interesting page regardless to read. So that's it. And again, if you're interested in what Igor has to say, that's where you can find it.